Good evening, and welcome to the Story of Liberty. This evening we have a very special interview. John Bona will be interviewing Kirk Cameron at the 2012 CPAC conference in Washington, D.C. Stay tuned.
Well, good morning, John Bona. Welcome to the Story of Liberty. I'm here with Kirk Cameron, and it's kind of launch day, right, Kirk, for the for Monumental, for your new film. You just finished an interview with CNN and headed over to see Senator Marco Rubio.
Yeah, that's right. Yep, we had a great time talking about the presentation of the film. They're going to be showing the trailer here at CPAC in just a little while, and we're taking a little break to talk with the senator, and then we'll be back for a day of press, and we have a chance to talk for 15 minutes right after the Speaker of the House about this brand new documentary.
So are you actually going to show like a trailer today of the film?
Yeah, we'll be showing the trailer. It's the official trailer for the film, and announcing that tickets go on sale today, starting today, for our live one-night-only theater event on March 27th. The movie will be screened kind of event-style with special guests and music on March 27th in 500 theaters around the country.
Yeah, we're actually driving through the streets of Washington right now, headed over to see the Senator Rubio, and just a lot of activity here. People going to work. It's early in the morning. And so it's a kind of a fun, packed day, Kirk, right? You've got back-to-back interviews, a presentation that you have to do in front of CPAC, which is probably the largest conservative political group that meets here in the entire country. This is kind of the mother of the events, isn't it?
It is. This is the mothership of all conservative political gatherings, and I think there's about 3,000 people that'll be sitting there this afternoon. So it's a little bit of a fish out of water. I'm really used to speaking in schools and churches and talking about movies or television programs, but to be here at CPAC it's a little scary. But everyone's been great so far, and we're all here for representing the same essential and core values that made America so great in the first place.
Yeah, I noticed on the agenda all the candidates are here. Rick Santorum, Romney, Newt, Ron Paul. I'm not sure if Ron Paul's here, but just about all the other ones are here. And so you're right in there in the mix today with kind of interesting stepping into the political arena in a way.
Yeah, John, when are you going to run for president?
Well, it's a long way.
What can you say?
Yeah, it's. This is a good day for Monumental, for the film, because the film will get some information out to the people that really haven't heard about it yet, and basically a conservative group that I noticed looking in that a lot of the people here that you said are mainly students. There's several students here, about half, right?
That's right. I was told about 12,000 people, half of them being students, which is great because that's exactly who we need to really understand the values that made America so unique and exceptional in the first place. And we need to get back to those values. You know, it's not going to be long before you and I are, bald and toothless, sitting in a rocking chair, and we're going to be looking to the youth of today to really understand how to run this country. So we're very excited that all these students are here.
Well, there you have it. Keep your antenna up for the March 27th release and coming to your town.
It's a live event. It's broadcast. It's simulcast live to over 500 theaters all at one time. It's a one-night only event in theaters. So get your tickets. They go on sale today. You can get them anywhere where tickets are sold. You can even go to our website at monumentalmovie.com or visit us on Facebook. And get tickets for your family, for your church, your school, your political club, your local organization, and experience this monumental moment together as we really go back and rediscover the people, the places, and the principles that founded this nation.
Thank you, Kirk. We'll catch up to you after you meet with the senator. Thanks.
All right. See you then.
God bless America.
Thank you for tuning in to The Story of Liberty. And now John Bona will continue his interview with Kirk Cameron after their meeting with Senator Marco Rubio.
We just went to Senator Rubio's office and got a chance to talk to the U.S. Senate chaplain, Dr. Black, and go into the prayer chapel. So what did you think? You met Senator Marco Rubio.
Yeah, he seemed like a great guy. And that's the GPS talking to us. Well, we're headed back to the CPAC event. But yeah, Senator Rubio was, we had a great time. He was talking to us about the beginnings of America and kind of the fundamental understanding that our rights were given to us in this country by God, not by the government. And so if we don't understand that, then we won't understand why it's wrong if the government begins to redefine those rights or take them away. Their job is simply to protect the rights that God has given us. So we had a great time. We talked with Dr. Black, and we got a little mini tour of some little-known places within the Capitol building, one of them being a special chapel room that not many people even know about. So that was really cool.
Yeah, it really was. I enjoyed just listening, hearing Marco's heart as he talked about the contrast between good and evil, liberty and tyranny, and how some people really get kind of sucked into the idea of thinking that socialism is a good thing, and just constantly looking to the government for a handout, where the truth is, it's not a good thing. It doesn't work, and he understands that. It leads to a bigger government, and it ends up taking away our liberties. And he explained that in a lot of detail for about a half hour.
And it's so good to be able to have people like that who are able to articulate things, they can think clearly about them, and help the rest of us really understand the issues and not get blindsided by a lot of political rhetoric.
Exactly. And, as we walked into that rotunda with our sons and seeing the pictures of the pilgrims holding the Bible, the Geneva Bible, praying, that other picture of George Washington coming over the Delaware, and all these pictures, all these beautiful paintings, it involves God, doesn't it? Every single painting shows that our nation was one nation under God. That's the whole theme.
Yeah, that's right. It's just everywhere. I mean, the issue is really clear if you know where to look, and you don't have to look very hard. You can look at the Supreme Court building right on the walls, right on the doors of the Supreme Court, all throughout the Capitol, the rotunda, if you see those paintings. And so, this is our heritage. This is our legacy, and this is the secret recipe that really made for the freest, most prosperous, secure nation in the whole world. And so we need to get back to that.
So, and that's why you're doing the film Monumental, really, because Monumental will show this proven strategy that does produce unending liberty and freedom and prosperity, all the good things. That come from this message of doing things God's way, from His Holy Scriptures.
Yeah, that's right. So we've got the plan. We got the game book. We've had it for 400 years, and it's produced an amazing nation. We haven't followed the plays perfectly, and every time we've strayed away from them, of course, we suffer the consequences. You can see the Civil War and other things that demonstrate that when you get off track, there's consequences to that. But we always come back to it. And I believe that there is a whole renewed interest in our core values and our founding beliefs in young people today. And that's evidenced by the fact you've got half the people at CPAC, thousands and thousands of people who are students. And they're beginning to understand these things and talk about them, put them on the table.
So we're leaving the Senator Rubio's office in the Capitol and headed over to CPAC, where you'll be speaking. What do you plan on speaking on today, in a couple hours from now?
Well, I'm going to be talking about Monumental, about the launch of this documentary and the event on March 27th, and encouraging people to really not get caught up in some of the rabbit trail subjects with the presidential debate. Sometimes it can turn into the ultimate reality show where you're digging up all kinds of dirt and scandals about people in their past. When the truth is, we need to be talking about the issues that are really going to be making a difference and making America healthy.
I heard it's a huge crowd here. 11,000 people coming, and almost half of them some kind of college student or in school, which is good. So there's a lot of young people. Marco mentioned that he said it's not your typical, you know, 65 or over guy in a vest. It's a lot of young people. That's kind of interesting. That brings me hope.
Yeah. Is it wrong to wear a vest? I don't know.
No, just if you're 65.
Oh, okay. Because I got kind of a sweater vest on. It's exciting. I'm excited to be here. This is kind of a new venue for me. But I'm learning a lot. And I'm excited to talk to people later this afternoon. I'm hoping to get a chance to reach out to some of the presidential candidates and see if I can't make sure that they see the film.
I was just curious, was there anything that sticks in your mind meeting Senator Rubio for the first time, who's definitely a presidential contender down the road, and some say has a very good chance if he ran right now would get the nomination, but he's not going to. Was there anything that stuck in your mind about meeting him and talking, kind of hearing his heart as he talked about God and faith?
Well, I got a sense of genuineness, which is always important to me. I think one of the things that people feel synonymous with politicians is that they're slick and kind of tell you what you want to hear. But I just got the sense that there was a genuineness in the things that he was saying, and he was speaking of the same values that are important to me and to my family. And he seemed to have a pretty good understanding of the history of this country and what it was that it's been founded on. And that's important to me as well. So I'm looking forward to talking with him more and hearing more from him.
That's great. We're driving back here on Connecticut, Pennsylvania Avenue, back to the CPAC. And then, Kirk, we'll catch up with you later after your speech, all right?
Okay, John.
All right, thanks.
God bless America.
Welcome back to the Story of Liberty. And now we will present the audio from Kirk Cameron's presentation of the Monumental movie at CPAC. We hope you enjoy.
Thank you, conservative friends, and especially thank you all, you moms and dads, who love this country like I do, and who love your children enough to teach them to hold tightly to the truths that have made this nation so great. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of all that God has called us to be. You know, I'm a bit of a fish out of water here. This is a new venue for me. I'm not a politician. I'm an actor. I'm a husband. I'm a father of six children. And I think in the past I've given lip service to these values as an American citizen, but now more than ever, with my children's skin in the game, they mean more to me than they ever have in the past. I had the privilege this morning of being with my executive producer and friend, John Bona, and also the Senate chaplain, Dr. Black, and we prayed together in the Capitol building. And it was so good to be there with men who still hold these truths to be sacred and are living them out in their life, even here in Washington. You know, the president that stands out most in my mind, as I'm sure it does with many of you, in my lifetime, that has made the most profound impact on me was President Ronald Reagan. And as a young man, I had the privilege of being on stage with President Reagan and meeting him. And I knew he was a great man at the time, but I didn't really understand all that he stood for and all that he lived for until the last few years, when I've been doing research for a brand new documentary film that I'm producing called Monumental, In Search of America's National Treasure. And I interviewed his son, Michael Reagan, and spent some time at the Western White House, the Reagan Ranch. And that's where I learned about his deep commitment to the history and heritage of our nation and to restoring these great truths. He famously communicated in one of his speeches, in light of the crisis that we face in our country and in the West in general, that the choice that we have is not left or right, but up or down. It's either going up to the maximum potential of individual liberty and freedom under the law and blessing under God, or down to what he called the ant heap of totalitarianism. And I think back in my growing pains days, I wouldn't have understood what all of that meant. But now that I understand the difference between freedom at the individual level and at the state level, over and against a top-down system that strips you of freedom and, in essence, enslaves people, is striking. And I believe that as we look around in our nation today, we can see that it's even more critical and even more of a monumental moment in history for us to be making the right choice between up or down. America has always been, in my mind, the envy of the world. It's always been the richest, freest, most prosperous nation. It's been strong, it's been secure. People bust down walls to get here. But as a father of six, I'm paying more attention to what's really going on. And as I look around, I get this sinking feeling that we're off track, that there's something sick in the soul of our country. I examine the fruit that's hanging on the tree of America, and I can see that it's rotting. And that concerns me deeply, economically. $15 trillion in debt. This is just devastating. I understand that morally. The very moral fabric of our nation is being eroded. The family is falling apart. Divorce is at an all-time high. Teenage pregnancy, drugs, alcohol, things that used to be shameful 50 years ago are now normalized in public school and celebrated on television. Spiritually, our motto, "In God We Trust," is written on our money, but today teachers are afraid that if they say it in school, they're breaking some sort of law. The meaning of separation of church and state has lost its original meaning. It's now a code word for secularizing the state. When something's wrong with the fruit, I've learned you don't take off the fruit and try to fix the fruit. You've got to understand that it's a systemic problem. You've got to dig down and look at the root and find out what's wrong down there. And as I did that through research for this new film that I'm doing, I found that the problem was worse than I thought it was. History tells me that it tends to repeat itself, and if nations are left long enough, eventually there tends to be some sort of a all-powerful state or ruler that will rise up and enslave the people, and the nation will be destroyed from within. It will implode. So I turn on the news and I'm trying to understand everyone that I see on Fox and CNN and C-SPAN and everywhere else, and I find that most people are playing the blame game. You know, as an inexperienced politician, I'm not a politician, I'm trying to understand the arguments, and with the right blaming the left blaming the right, business blaming government, and government blaming big business, and then the church blames the media for all the problems, and the media blames religion for all the ills of the world. I'm thinking, it's difficult to hear a clear voice on how to get us out of this mess. And then I think to myself, maybe it's simpler than all this. It's got to be. Maybe it's as simple as we've just forgotten what made this country such a great nation in the first place. Maybe we've forgotten who we are and the values that produced out of a wilderness the greatest nation the world's ever known, the freest nation in the world. If only I could go back and talk to the men and women who built this country, they could look at what we're doing and say, here's what you're doing wrong and here's how to fix it. I wish my name was Marty McFly and I had a DeLorean and I could just go back and talk with them and learn from them. But since I'm not, I did the next best thing. I bought a ticket and I went to England, and I retraced the escape route of the pilgrims. Before they were pilgrims, they were called separatists, and I followed them into the dungeons and the castles that they were thrown into, and the underground secret meeting places, and then made a strategic escape to Holland, where they stayed for 12 years before they got on the Mayflower and came across the Atlantic to the New World and laid the foundation for this nation. And what I discovered blew my mind about who they were and why they came here and where they got their ideas from. And it changed everything I thought I knew about the origins of our country and about the pilgrims. They were not just a suffering, sacrificing band of wimps in funny costumes with belt buckles on their shoes. These were the radicals of their day. These were the free thinkers. the heroes who produced a free enterprise system. They were successful. They formed a constitutional government. Everything that America would become famous for. Economic freedom, the ability to own your own land and a business and then bless your family with what you've created and worked hard for. Religious freedom. Freedom to worship God according to the dictates of your own conscience, rather than having a religion crammed down your throat by the government or the king. Political freedom. The ability to elect your own leaders, men and women of character. A system that was of the people, by the people, for the people. All of these ideas were planted in the hearts and minds of those pilgrims by their pastor, John Robinson, in Holland. And so you had the seeds of a brand new nation, something that had not been manifested since the ancient Hebrew Republic thousands of years earlier, floating in the belly of a boat across the Atlantic Ocean, being ready to be planted in this virgin soil and give birth to the freest nation in the world 150 years later. And the source of those ideas, the rocket fuel, was so powerful, it gave them great faith. It gave them big, optimistic vision for the future. And it gave them unstoppable courage. And the best part about it is that I discovered that they knew we would get off track. They knew, they had the foresight to understand that we were a forgetful and selfish people by nature. We need to be brought back to what is right and true. And so they left us a map, a paper trail that would lead us back to the treasure if we ever forgot our way. And the great thing is that this map is not hidden. It's not under a monument or buried beneath a lake. It's in plain sight. It's in 180 tons of granite. It's the largest granite monument in America, overlooking Plymouth, Massachusetts, on top of a hill, hidden in a residential area, and hardly anyone knows it's there. It is so beautiful, it is so true, and it's so clear. It's called the Monument to the Forefathers. It perfectly lays out the recipe for how to build and sustain a free and just society with faith at the center, transforming the heart from the inside, producing character and morality and courage on the outside that leads to freedom and lasting liberty. In fact, it's so beautiful. I'm surprised some anti-faith organization has not tried to demo it. I would like for you to watch this trailer of a brand new film coming out in March of Monumental.
Thank you so much for tuning in to the first half of The Story of Liberty. After the break, we will continue with Kirk Cameron's presentation of Monumental at CPAC. We will also continue John Bona's interview with Kirk Cameron. Stay tuned! Welcome back to The Story of Liberty, and we now continue Kirk Cameron's presentation of Monumental at CPAC, followed by John Bona's interview with Kirk Cameron. Thank you, and stay tuned.
There are those who would have us believe that the United States has reached the zenith of its power, that we're weak and fearful, reduced to bickering with each other. I don't agree that our nation must resign itself to inevitable decline.
America is the richest, freest nation the world has ever seen. But as a father of six, I look around and all signs tell me something is sick in the soul of our country.
And history tells me that we're headed for disaster if we don't change our course now. The set of ideas that is being implemented and advanced in this capital at this time is terribly frightening to people who are students of history.
If you look at the 70 superpowers in history, every single one of them has called themselves exceptional.
When you look at the Roman Empire, the parallels to what is going on in America are absolutely frightening.
And the question is, are we going to go the right path ourselves, or are we going to continue down the wrong path that so many nations have fallen into?
I went on a journey to retrace the footsteps of our forefathers to see if they left us some kind of a map that would guide us back to the foundation of America's success.
When I think of pilgrims, I think of what I was taught in history class. Think of pilgrims coming over in these funny black and white suits with big hats and belt buckles on their shoes.
These are the people out of the box. These are the radicals of the day.
Can you imagine? Chained here, and you're open to the elements.
You can read about places like this. You can smell the history.
You can't fake this.
Welcome to Mayflower 2.
So you have 102 people in this area.
Look at that. I mean, can you imagine? You're going to be sharing that.
It's actually quite comfortable.
What I discovered is that our history has not just been forgotten, it's been rewritten.
I'm stunned just what's on this table. I mean, this alone would change everyone's perspective about what made America such a great nation.
Time is flying by too quickly, and our children's futures won't wait. We've got to do something now.
Why is this monument not being showcased more? It is illustrating the principles of what this country is all about, and it's falling apart.
There is nothing in today's America that cannot be solved by a genuine going back to the American first principles.
That's good news.
Very good news. I'm looking for good news.
This is the most important journey of my life. My family is worth fighting for, and so is yours.
I stand here with you today and add my voice to the increasing realization that we must occupy this land with truth. And moms and dads who love God and will teach their children the right worldview. That we must right our wrongs and heal our land through hard work and sacrifice and charity. And get back to a plan that has worked for 400 years. I've learned that hope for my family's future, for our nation, does not begin at the White House. It begins at your house, at my house. And that the land of the free starts in the homes of the brave. I need your help. I'm asking you to please help me reach families with this message. I'm eager to get material into your hands and to help you to reach the millions of people that feel like we do. And I believe that together we can secure a monumental future for our children. I have great hope for a bright future, and I'm full of optimism. There's two ways that you can help. Number one, buy tickets to see this film. This is a live, one-night-only simulcast event in over 500 theaters across the country. Buy tickets to see this event. Again, this event is on March 27th, and tickets are on sale now. God bless you.
Well, hi, John Bona back there with Kirk Cameron. Long day here in Washington, Kirk.
Oh, it was. It's been a long day. We're kind of ready to hit the sack and go to sleep. But it's been a full day, and it's been really exciting. So many people here. Over 10,000 people, a lot of young people, in a room that's packed with about 2,500 people. Governor Rick Perry, Speaker of the House. We did so many exciting things. Well, this morning we prayed with the Senate Chaplain, Dr. Black. We had a chance to meet with Senator Rubio in his office and talk about some important things, and do a ton of press. Went up and down Radio Alley and spoke with people from all kinds of different radio and TV programs. had the speech, showed the trailer to Monumental, the movie, went out and had dinner with the Duggar family.
Yeah.
That was a trip. We had some chili dogs with the Duggars. And boy, it's been a real full day.
It really was. You know, being in the audience when you were giving your speech right after Rick Perry, and I think John Boehner was before him.
Okay.
So you had the Speaker of the House and then Rick Perry, who gave a very passionate speech about freedom and liberty. And it kind of set the stage for you really well. You came up and talked about the strategy of the film you're doing, Monumental. I've had the pleasure of working with you for the last couple of years on. And the film Monumental will be released nationwide March 27th in several hundred theaters. And so we encourage our listeners to, wherever you're hearing this, to get out to your theaters on March 27th for Monumental. You know, as you were describing the film, then you showed the clip of Monumental, it dawned on me as I was in the audience looking at people how there's a legitimate concern about their families. And in fact, I heard one lady say, as I was walking by when you were finishing, she made the comment, she said, well, how is this going to affect my family? Or how's it going to affect your family, this message? And it was very profound. I've been thinking about it all day since I heard her say it. You know, how's this going to affect my family? How would you respond to that, the message of this film?
Well, that's a good question. I think the first thing is to inspire people. I'm hoping that the message of Monumental will inspire other families like it has inspired me and my wife. And it causes us to stay up at night after the kids go to sleep and talk about these things. What does it mean to say that the pilgrims came to America? Why did they come? What makes America unique and special in the history of the world? What does it mean to be free? Is there such a thing as the government can take away our freedoms? And what would that look like? Has any nation ever demonstrated what happens when freedom gets taken away? And the answer, of course, is yes to all these things. And once we talk about them, you start to form these new convictions like me and my wife have. And we begin to think differently about how to educate our children. We begin to think differently about voting at the booth. And when we begin educating our children differently and have our convictions about our faith, our church, and our government, you begin instilling those things into your kids, and within a generation or two, you can have a nation that looks entirely different. I mean, you can bring back liberty and prosperity and just resurrect it from the dead. So it's going to affect people's families, I think, in a very profound way. Not with a 10-step program on how to fix America in a year or in 4 years, but encouraging people to understand that God works in long-term plans. You know, the pilgrims had a 200-year plan, and it started with them in their homes with their children. And they never actually saw what a great nation they had begun. But with the eyes of faith, they believed that it would happen because they were standing on the promises of God and doing the right thing over the long haul. That's what I think we need to get back to.
Well said. You know, as you were describing the monument, and you went in some detail today, you spoke for maybe 15 minutes and showed the clip. And as you described the monument, I noticed the look of surprise on some people. They never knew it existed. In fact, most of the people, you've been interviewed today by all the networks, you know, NBC, I guess it was, CNN, several radio personalities. Everywhere you went, you were getting interviewed. And I don't know how those interviews, if they got into this discussion, but I noticed a look of, you know, I never heard of this before.
Right.
And I don't know why. It's kind of interesting that the message of this monument, it's not complicated. It's been around a long time. And yet, most people in America, the high percentage of people, don't know about. Why is that?
You know, I'm a little miffed, too. I mean, I hate to say that the monument in Plymouth, Massachusetts, is being hidden, because that just sounds terrible to say that someone would try to hide a monument like that. But you start to wonder when you go see it, it's not being taken care of. There's no lights to light it up at night. The landscaping looks terrible. The fingers are falling off of Law, and there's a bird nest on top of Faith the last time we saw her. It's surrounded by a forest of trees that are almost as tall as the monument in a residential area. And the tour buses barely even stop when they go by it. So you have to at least conclude that it's been forgotten. Why is that? Well, just like Reagan said that great change begins at the dinner table, you know, not at the White House, but at your house, I think we've forgotten to teach our children what it means to be an American. I think we've forgotten to teach our children the values and the principles that parents used to teach their children and that caused people to build that monument in the first place. So, since we're not doing it with our kids, the buses don't stop and the lights don't come on, and we're more interested in what the Kardashians are doing or what the latest scandal is, the latest TV show with the latest pop star, that we're not paying attention to the things that really matter.
As we were walking around the Capitol today in the rotunda and looking at all the beautiful paintings of the Pilgrim Landing and George Washington, and it dawned on me as we were looking at those that the message is still there. Just like the Forefathers Monument, it's right in front of us. And I know you've been preaching this for some time. It's not that the message has gone away. The remnant of the message is all over America.
Right.
Yet, it's not necessarily at this point in time, at the time of the CPAC convention here in Washington, in the hearts and minds of the people of America yet. And I know that has to be your hope. It is with mine with the film Monumental, that the impact that Monumental will make on this nation, that I really believe it will. Because the message itself is so clear. The strategy is so clear. It's easy to understand. And as we realize as Christians, there really isn't another strategy that'll work. To really bring back, as you were saying, the long-term plan. We're not talking about, you know, the next administration or the next year or so, although it could make an impact. We're talking about the future for our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, our children down the road. And that's really the kind of vision that you have to have. It really is the vision that the great Pastor John Robinson had, wasn't it, the Pilgrim? Tell us a little bit. I know you've been a student of John Robinson. Anything I read about him, I love reading about Pastor John Robinson, who was the pastor's pilgrim, who gave these basic teachings of trusting God to believe in the future, that he would do something for the future, for the posterity of the future generations that would trust in him, right? That's an enormous message for any parent, any grandparent, isn't it?
Absolutely. You know, I think that's what made John Robinson so unique, especially compared to many Christians today. He had a long-term vision. And again, they believe that if you plant seeds today and those seeds get watered, over the course of generations, they will bear fruit. And to your point earlier, yes, there's images. It's clear. This city of Washington, you can see the remnants of God's Word and of His laws all over the rotunda, in the paintings, in the chapels, in the Supreme Court buildings, in the statues, and the monuments, everywhere. It speaks of faith in Almighty God and in His Word. But, you know, I, I think of Europe too, and I think of how many beautiful chapels there are, and how many cathedrals there are, and how many monuments that are still standing that are absolutely gorgeous. But most of them have been turned into many of them have been turned into restaurants or theaters or tattoo parlors or bars and pubs. And so I think you said it right. It doesn't matter how many monuments we have. What we need is to get the spirit of our forefathers and get the spirit of our faith back into the hearts of the people. Because that's really all those monuments do for us. They remind us of where we came from. They remind us of the strategy, of the answer. But ultimately it comes down to the gospel, which needs to change the heart first. It's the Holy Spirit. It's being in connection and relationship with God through faith in Christ that changes you into the kind of person that wants to live these things out and teach them to your kids. And again, that's the whole strategy. That's how they did it, and that's how we'll continue to do it. There's no other way.
That's good news. I know millions of Americans feel that way, and they believe that. They have faith in Christ. They have faith in God's word. As the monument clearly shows, that that's where it all begins. To have faith in God and in His word. You know, as we were, as you mentioned earlier, when we were with the United States Senate chaplain today in his office, and he was getting ready. He had a prayer prepared, written out. And he opened it up in front of us and asked us to pray with him as he was about to go out. He asked you to pray. As he asked, he was going out to pray to open the day session in the Senate. And we were walking out, he said a beautiful prayer, and he went out to pray. And I seen some senators walk by. They were going to join him, and they were going there for that purpose. And regardless of how I look at that particular senator that was going there, whether I agreed with him politically or not, he was still going for the prayer. So it gave me hope. Even if that particular person was a believer or not, it showed me that this was still something that individual had the choice to go to or not. Yet he chose to go be involved with the opening prayer today. So that gives me hope for America, to see that we have senators, as we know, Marco Rubio this morning, who talked about God and family and the importance of his faith in God, that everything begins there for him. And so even though we're all concerned about, I have hope. I have hope for America. I have hope for America because there's a remnant here. There are people, as Alveda King said, who still call on the name of the Lord. They do.
That's right.
And there's a lot of us. Now, it doesn't always mean that things are always going to go right, things are going to go our way, the economy is going to heal overnight, there won't be conflicts around the world, some which we may get involved with and have to center our boys over there. But the reality is there's great hope for this nation. There's great hope. We don't have to have this negative view that the bus is over the cliff. And even if the bus is at the edge of the cliff, God is still in control. He's sovereign. And if His people will just turn back to Him, as Scripture says, right, in 2 Chronicles 7:14. If you think of that, I know people talk about that all the time. We hear it all the time. My people are called by my name, Lord. Turn from their wicked ways, you know. Well, I hear it in church. I hear people say it. But if people did that, there's the healing balm right there. That's the balm to heal the wound. And there's enough of us. It's not all of us. But there's enough of us to do that. And so that's my hope, that I see these people, you can see their heart. And even in our government, as you and I experienced today, Kurt, it gives me hope.
Well, it gives me hope too, and you know, it's easy to get very pessimistic when we look at some of the troubles that we're having, but
the reality is there's great hope for this nation. There's great hope. We don't have to have this negative view that the bus is over the cliff. And even if the bus is at the edge of the cliff, God is still in control. He's sovereign. And if his people will just turn back to him, as Scripture says, right, in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if you think of that, I know people talk about that all the time. We hear it all the time. If my people are called by my name, will turn from their wicked ways, you know. Well, I hear it in church. I hear people say it. But if people did that, there's the healing balm right there. That's the balm to heal the wound. And there's enough of us. It's not all of us, but there's enough of us to do that. And so that's my hope, that I see these people, you can see their heart. And even in our government, as you and I experienced today, Kirk, it gives me hope.
Well, it gives me hope too. And you know, it's easy to get very pessimistic when we look at some of the troubles that we're having. But you know, just like in marriage. I mean, John, you're married. I'm married. You know, we have children, and you know, there are times when you go through seasons of challenge and difficulty, and you struggle with things, right? And you say things that hurt
right.
one another.
Sure.
And you're not perfect, but you know what you need to do. You need to love your wife. I need to love my wife. But when we make mistakes, it doesn't mean it's over. It doesn't mean, you know, throw in the towel and get divorced. There is hope. And there's hope when your heart is together with God and your heart is willing to fight for your marriage. Right? And so you stick it out and you have a long-term view and you say, babe, we're in this forever. You know, we're going to the grave. And you work it out and you work together and you fight for one another. And we need to do that with our country. And there's a lot of people who feel like we do. They want to fight for this nation. They want to fight for freedom. They want to fight for their children and for their children's future. And we know what to do. The hard part is just doing it. The strategy's been laid out for us in the Forefathers Monument and the Constitution, the Declaration. Now we just need to, you know, put our nose down and be faithful and do those things and help one another to fight through the struggles, the challenging parts. We need to ask for forgiveness, trust in the Lord, and you know, get off the defense, get on the offense, make a plan and declare victory.
It's exciting that Monumental will be you're wrapping up now. You're probably 98% of the way there, putting the final touches on. I know you're working real hard. Appreciate your Puritan work ethic, you know, to get it done.
Just to be able to sit in a real movie theater and watch it with a live audience and the 5.1 surround sound, full color, is going to be very exciting. So, you know, we should get together and watch it together when it comes out on the 27th.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Well, Kirk Cameron, thank you again for your time. I know you had a long day here. You know, every time I turned around, you were getting interviewed somewhere.
This crowd is a lot of the same people that I do speak to in schools and in churches. They're moms and dads. They've got kids. They have conservative values. They have faith in God. They love this country. They don't want the government to be telling them what to do. They want to have you know, freedom to do all the things that the people here at CPAC want to be able to do.
Well, thanks again, Kirk. Godspeed, and have a safe trip back to California.
All right. Thanks, John. You too.